This is the 17th annual Martin Luther King breakfast. And to begin right away, just so we can get going with the breakfast, I'd like to invite Reverend Darrell Malden, pastor of the Bethel AME Church of Fall River, to provide our invocation. And while Reverend Malden is coming up, I think you should know that there's a service after this breakfast at on Hanover Street at Bethel AME. I hope you can all attend. Please welcome Reverend Darrell Malden.
Thank you, Dr. Spriga. And again, to reiterate, there is a worship service, a short worship service. Did I say short?
No.
A short worship service at 11 a.m. at the church I pastor, Bethel AME Church, here in Fall River. That's 146 Hanover Street. So please come and let's worship together. Martin Luther King said of the 11 o'clock hour on Sunday is one of the most segregated hours in the country. So let's make the 11 o'clock hour on Monday, this Monday, an hour that we're all together. Amen. Let us pray. Heavenly Father, in your word, you say that there is neither Jew nor Greek, there is neither Jew nor Gentile. Neither slave nor free, nor there is male or female, but we are all one under God. And so with that in mind, God, we just thank you for the gathering here today. We ask that your spirit dwell with us as we remember and reflect on the life and legacy of the Reverend Dr. Martin Luther King Jr. But I believe that he would have us not remember him, but for what he stood for, of freedom, of justice, of love, and of hope. And he said that in this dark age that darkness cannot drive out darkness, but you need light to drive out darkness, and you need love to drive out darkness. So your children of light are gathered here on this day, hoping in this hour in America where there are so many challenges. We are at a fork in the road in America, and we must choose whether we're going to love or hate, whether we're going to be divided or unified. And God, as we choose, we just pray that your spirit will be with us as we choose to follow the direction of love, as we choose to follow the direction of unity, as we choose to follow the direction of hope, that your spirit will guide us, not only today, but for tomorrow, not only for the people now, but for our children. And as always, God, we will remember to give you the thanks and the praise. So bless your people as we celebrate today. In your name we pray. Will somebody say amen?
Amen. Amen.
This is the 17th annual Martin Luther King Jr. Community Breakfast at BCC. I established this program 17 years ago, if you can believe it. I'm very proud of what we've accomplished here at the college. And unfortunately, a sad, bittersweet occasion. This is my last breakfast as a presiding official. I certainly will attend in the future, but I will be retiring this summer. I thank you for your support over the years. Some of you have been veterans, been here all 17 years, and I thank you. Oh, please. Thank you very much. Thank you. Thank you very, very much. It is I who should be applauding you for your great support for the community. Thank you so much. And this is our breakfast, our annual opportunity to celebrate the life and the contributions of Dr. King. Each year we use this time to focus on a quote from his most famous speech, the I Have a Dream speech, and it's the one about being judged not by the color of your skin, but by the content of your character. It is a tradition at BCC to celebrate Dr. King's values on the day set aside to remember his legacy. And it is appropriate for us to do so because what Dr. King held dear is what BCC holds dear. Social justice, equality, opportunity for all are standards, and they are BCC goals as well. You know, when Dr. King, I frequently mention when he was in the Birmingham jail, some other black ministers would criticize him and say, Martin, why are you doing this? Why are you causing trouble? You're only calling attention to yourself and us and in a negative way. So why are you speaking out? And he had a very simple answer. He said, I go where injustice is. And there was injustice in Birmingham, and not only in Birmingham, but that was the way he lived his life. And unfortunately, it cost him his life in Memphis later on. But these are the things that he held dear. I love a quote from Dr. King also. He said that we should accept finite disappointment, but never lose infinite hope. And that is a way that the phrase always comes to mind. I don't think it was Dr. King's, that keep hope alive. And that was certainly the way that he lived his life. Now, if I could, we're going to change the program just a bit. We've been honored by the presence of Mayor Jaisal Correa of Fall River, who is on his way to the airport, believe it or not, and agreed to stop in and bring greetings because of the importance of this occasion that he wanted to be part of. So I would invite to the podium Mayor of Fall River, the Honorable Jaisal Correa.
Okay. Good evening. Good evening. Good afternoon. Is it afternoon? No, it's still morning. Good morning, everybody. If I could just have your attention, please. I know we have some people gathering some food, but I do have some important greetings on behalf of the city. And we also are honoring, beside Martin Luther King Jr. today, we're honoring Jack Sprague, who has been an extraordinary president of Bristol Community College and made this breakfast possible for the last 17 years. So please, yes. And I've gotten to know Jack, and he's one of the most humble, most incredible men I've ever met. Even as people were applauding him and standing, he was still worried about me over there and if I'd be next to speak. So he's just an incredible man, and thank you so much. Last year at this speech, on this day, I talked about the I Have a Dream speech. And I talked about how I find it interesting. Every time I read it, I keep drifting from the word I to the word we. And in that speech, Martin Luther King Jr. said the word we over 37 times. I think it's exactly 37 times. And the power of we is really, I think, his message throughout his entire life. That all together, no matter the race, the creed, the color, whatever it may be, that together we can accomplish great things. So his message of equality rings true so many years later and will continue to. And as I'm on my way to the airport, I'm actually on my way to Washington, D.C. this afternoon. On my way down to the Mayor's Conference, U.S. Mayor's Conference for the week. I will stop by the monument and have, how many people have seen Martin Luther King Jr.'s monument? We have a few? Yep, very good, yes. Well, if you haven't seen it, I want to describe it to you. It's beautiful, I think it's limestone. I think that's what most are made out of, limestone or marble. And it's this beautiful cutout almost. So on this side, if you imagine the podium being the actual figure, Martin Luther King Jr. in stone. On this side and this side, you have a cutout of sculpted stone. And then you have the sculpture coming out of the middle. And when I looked at this for the first time, immediately I thought of the struggle that so many people are facing in their lives, and that sometimes you have to break through, and that you have to keep fighting for the things that are right and just. And I think that symbol in that monument is so true and so unique and really resonates with so many people and so many lives. So I encourage you to, at least we have the wonderful, we're in the wonderful age of technology. You can take a look on your iPhones or Androids and take a look at the monument or visit it yourself. But please remember that message and please be kind to each other. Promote Martin Luther King Jr.'s message each day of your life. And thank you for coming to this breakfast this morning. I also want to give a huge round of applause to some of our wonderful student volunteers that are throughout the room. Please give them a huge round of applause today. They're going to be going to the Boys and Girls Club later this afternoon to talk about Dr. King and his message. So thank you. And I think it's so important that a young person is going to hear the stories of Martin Luther King Jr. from another young person and how important that message is. That really is a wonderful thing in our community. I also want to recognize some of the Fall River elected officials. I know that other elected officials were introduced, their other colleagues, but my colleagues that I serve with on a daily basis in Fall River, we have from the City Council, we have Steve Camara. Thank you, Councilor Camara, for being here. From the School Committee, we have Joe Martins from the School Committee. Thank you for being here. And from the School Committee, we also have Paul Coogan. Thank you. So thank you, everybody. I think that's all the I know that we have the state delegation, also partners in government. Thank you for being here. We have our district attorney as well, and they'll be introduced shortly. So lastly, before I sneak out to go to the airport, which I wish I could stay with all of you, but I do have to catch that flight, we have a citation here for a man that I truly respect so much. And like I said earlier, such a humble man, such an incredible individual who has really made such an impact on so many thousands and thousands of people's lives in our community. And we're sad to see him retire at the end of the year, but I know he'll still be involved. And that's, of course, PCC President Jack Sprague. Thank you so much for everything you've done.
Thank you very much. Very good. Very good.
Thank you, and God bless everybody.
Mayor Correa, ladies and gentlemen, please welcome, thank him for his participation. Safe trip down to Washington. Here's the mayor's citation. You know, I came to first thought about retiring when at an occasion where the mayor had to introduce me at a speaking engagement. And he said that I've been here 17 years, and in his life, he doesn't remember anybody being the president of Bristol Community College except me in those 17 years. So I said, oh no, it's time to get out. But I thank him for all that, and we're very grateful that he could take the time to be with us. This is a great celebration that we have. Some people could not be with us, and I wanted to play video they were very so kind as to offer a video in lieu of their being able to be with us in person. And we have three videos for you to see. One is from Senator Elizabeth Warren. One from Congressman William Keating, and the other from Congressman Joseph Kennedy. So if we could, Ray, we'll play those and move forward. But I'm very grateful to them for the fact that they could take the time and trouble to acknowledge our breakfast here at Bristol Community College, even though they couldn't be with us. So let's see what they have to say. Thank you.
And happy Martin Luther King Jr. Day. I wish I could be there at Bristol Community College today to help celebrate, but at least I'm glad to have this chance to say hello by video. I want to take this opportunity to offer my warmest wishes to President Sprague on his upcoming retirement, and to offer my thanks for his many years of dedicated service to the college, to BCC students, and to the whole community. He's really been a terrific guy. Each year, Martin Luther King Jr. Day serves as a powerful reminder of Dr. King's vision for a more equal society and of the solemn responsibility that each of us has to realize his dream in our schools, in our workplaces, and in our communities. Today, we celebrate the significant achievements of the Civil Rights Movement, but we also recognize that we have much work to do to protect those gains and to build on that legacy. Whenever we see efforts to restrict voting rights of our fellow citizens, whenever Black Americans fear violence at the hands of those sworn to protect them, and as long as systemic racism limits economic opportunities for communities of color, then we must recall Dr. King's words. injustice anywhere is a threat to justice everywhere. And we must act. We must act for a more just society. We must act to make Dr. King's dream a reality, not just for some, but for all. So thank you for the chance to join you for this celebration and for this moment of reflection. And happy Martin Luther King Jr. Day.
Good morning. I want to thank Bristol Community College for allowing me to participate in your annual breakfast to honor the life of Dr. Martin Luther King Jr. I also want to congratulate Christopher Oyenuga, the 2017 Distinguished African American Alumnus of the Year. What a great honor it is for Christopher to be recognized in memory of Dr. Martin Luther King's legacy. I also want to congratulate Dr. Jack Sprague for his hard work and the hard work of his staff in making this event an annual success. We all know Dr. King's dream of inclusion. We all know it well. But there's another King I'd like to quote for you today, and it's a person I had the privilege to meet years ago, Coretta Scott King. She said, "Freedom and justice cannot be parceled out in pieces to suit political convenience." I don't believe you can stand for freedom for one group of people and deny it for others. You know, these are challenging times in our country, and over the last year, we've seen so much violence and hate and bigotry. Americans against Americans. The opposite of Dr. King's dream of peace and inclusion. We must join together to ensure our country remains the best version of America we can be, where everyone is welcomed, everyone is included, where the calls for peace and equality from both Martin and Coretta King are really heeded. But we know that there are forces in our nation that make this work challenging. So I commend Bristol Community College for hosting celebrations like this and for your role in supporting our leaders of tomorrow. And I commit today to you that I'll stand together with you to keep Dr. Martin Luther King's legacy alive here in Massachusetts and all across our nation, and to work with you towards achievement of his dream.
Good morning, ladies and gentlemen. I'm Congressman Joe Kennedy. I'm so sorry that I can't be there with you in person to celebrate the life and legacy of Dr. King, but I'm grateful to have a couple of minutes to share my own thoughts on the world that he continues to leave behind today. When I think of the legacy of Dr. King, I believe in his dedication to nonviolence, his belief in the dignity of every single person, and his aspiration that every single one of us can make a difference, and we all should try. Given the challenges we face at home, across our community, across our Commonwealth, across our nation, around the world, I can't think of a more poignant lesson for us to take with us today. By gathering together here this morning, you all recommit yourselves to his life, to his legacy, and to making our world a little bit fairer, kinder, and better for us and the next generation. I'm grateful for that. I'm grateful for the honor to be called myself your congressman to continue to serve you in Washington, D.C. Please let us know how we can do so. Thank you. Good morning, ladies and gentlemen. I'm Congressman Joe Kennedy. I'm so sorry.
All right, thank you. Well, I hope you enjoyed the breakfast, and if you're not finished, please continue. There's plenty of food up there. Our annual Martin Luther King Jr. Celebration is a collaboration of the college, members of the community, joined together to recognize the groundbreaking life and work of Dr. King. This is not a day off, but a day on, to remember Dr. King's dreams and goals and to continue moving toward them. Please recall, too, that here at BCC, our opening ceremony for our African American History Month begins on February 1st, and everyone is invited to participate in that ceremony. And, of course, the full month of February, although we should not just reserve 1 month to celebrate that African-American history. It's a 12-month, 24/7 project for all of us. Please note in particular, too, that there is a free credit course offering starting on Monday evenings for 5 weeks. It doesn't begin until March 27th, and it's based on the readings of Dr. King. This is a wonderful opportunity to read Dr. King's work and discuss it, and also get credit for it free. You can sign up today in the back of the cafeteria, right over there by the doorway. And I want to thank Dr. Ronald Weisberger for establishing and continuing this tradition. This event is organized by, and Dr. Weisberger has done this every year, so we're very proud of his work in the history department and working with us. This event is, the course is organized by a committee that works all year to develop. And I want to recognize our breakfast committee, Tafa Awolaju and Joyce Brennan, our co-chairs, Philomena Pont, Eliz McCarthy, Rob Resendiz, Kevin Sperlett, and Dr. Weisberger. I also want to acknowledge our musicians today who set such a wonderful atmosphere during the breakfast. Please join me to welcome Louis Lima and Michael Crowley. They've been doing it virtually every year as well. This breakfast has become a community tradition in Fall River, and I would like to acknowledge some of our community leaders who have joined us at this this morning. We have Senator, the mayor. He said he was in a hurry. I didn't think he was going to introduce people as well. It took it right on my script, but I wanted to be sure we acknowledge the presence of Senator Michael Rodericks, Senator Modrick, Representative Alan Sylvia, Representative Carol Fiola, Representative Steve Howitt, Representative Keiko Oral. Representative Paul Schmidt, District Attorney Thomas Quinn. We have, you met already, City Councilor Steve Camara. Fall River Chamber of Commerce President Rob Melian is here. Hey. Fall River School Committee, you met Joseph Martins and Paul Coogan. And we have from the New Bedford School Committee, Joaquin Lacimento, out there in the back. There he is, Jack. Let's see, I want to be sure I get everyone here. Joan Menard is here. Joan Menard. She's an honorary senator, I guess. I don't know. We have trustees. Vice chair of our Board of Trustees, Diane Sylvia, is here. There she is. And Cynthia Rose, former vice chair of the trustees. I think that's everybody. Well, John McDonough from the battleship. John, I couldn't forget you. Thank you. Okay. We are joined as a sponsorship, as I mentioned, with the city and our annual middle school poster contest. I hope you took the opportunity to see the posters out in the lobby. We have teachers and administrators from our various schools who are here to honor their students. And I wanted to just mention some of them to you. Sandra Arnold is here, Jackie Arnfield, Nancy Moangeli, Linda Cabral, Jennifer Mate, Eric Millett, Michelle DeGagne. We have from the New Bedford Regional Vocational Assistant Principal Wari Williams. Some of these people have been with us since the start, organizing the contests and working with their students to prepare for this day. So I thank them very much. Please acknowledge their great contributions to this event. To Dr. King's historic march, the Board of Trustees at BCC created an essay competition inviting BCC students to write about the meaning of Dr. King's dreams and also his ideals. A faculty and staff committee took on the challenging task of choosing the winning entrees. In third place, receiving a cash award of $100, is Miranda Daniels. Miranda Daniels of Taunton. Second place, Jennifer Cassidy of Berkeley. Jennifer Cassidy, come forward, please. And the winner of our essay contest is from Attleboro, Robert Donyan. Robert, come forward.
Second place.
Thank you.
Thank you
very
much. Oh, yeah.
So now we're going to hear from Robert Donyan of the essay that was the prize-winning essay. Robert?
Thank you.
All right. Good morning, everyone. Thank you for coming. I'd like to thank the BCC for the opportunity, and I'd also like to thank my mom. Without you, I'd be lost. August 28, 1963, a man had a dream. The words expressed by Martin Luther King Jr. on that day still holds relevance today. For even today, the plight of these individuals continues. The unjust violence committed by police against blacks is still ever present. The marches and protests are still ongoing, and I know not the end. But through his words, I understand that to be satisfied with the gradualism of change is truly detrimental. Looking at injustices around the world against all people, I understand how the procrastination of justice is an acceptance of injustice. For freedom and equality are not held by all, so we must be unrelenting to fight for them. As a child, the ideas of freedom and judging others on the content of their character seemed commonplace. But the older I became and the more knowledge I acquired, I learned that the truths that were said to be held self-evidently, such as all men are created equal, was hypocrisy. For at the time these words were written, there was slavery. This left me with a hardened heart. Though the descendants of the captors in my life were far removed, I found myself distrusting of them. And I applied the sins of their fathers to them. I found myself filled with a bitterness, the very bitterness MLK warned against. Reading more of his speech, I wondered how he overcame the crippling manacles of segregation and the chains of discrimination without violent retaliation or succumbing to the idea of segregation. Then I realized that his very humanity and philosophy is expressed throughout his speech. In attendance that day were not just blacks, but white brothers, as he called them. In his speech, he referenced their attendance and how it showed that they too were fighting for the freedom and equality that the Negro was trying to attain. This showed that in this struggle, it was not to be burdened by blacks alone, but to be shared with all. His belief that we are in fact all created equal led to a movement that thought that though it was brought on by racial segregation, it could in fact bring about the racial integration of those who were divided. And thus, my disheartening of past atrocities was remedied with hope from MLK's words. For I remember when I was a child, I held the same sentiment of humanity as he still that day in August. And his dream I started to realize. I was able to join hands with little white boys and white girls as sisters and brothers with no fear of persecution. Within the last 8 years of this country, the people elected a president for two terms who is in part of that black minority, something at the time of that civil rights movement was almost unthinkable. Racism isn't completely vanished from the face of any nation, but I see that his words have inspired others to having compassion for their fellow man and a view that we are all truly equal. Wednesday, August 28th, 1963, a man had a dream, and I thank him for it.
Robert Donyon, ladies and gentlemen, from Attleboro. Thank you, Robert. Wonderful. I also want to acknowledge the president of Glenda Izaguirre from Representative William Keating's office here. Very good of him to make the video as well. Now we're moving the program a bit, but I want to introduce and ask to come up to the stage the chief of staff for Mayor Correa, who had to leave, and Michael Hoare is here to bring greetings from the city and also announce the winners of the poster contest. The educators and students worked hard on this year's contest. I hope you had a chance to view them in the lobby. If not, you'll be able to see them on the way out. So please, if you could, welcome Michael Hoare.
Michael, congratulations. I try to put some pronunciations for you.
Okay, very good. Thank you, Dr. Sprager. This is quite an honor to be here on two levels. Number one, representing the city. And the second is being a graduate of BCC. Long time ago, when BCC was on Durfee Street, was my first class. And I watched BCC grow over the years. And as you know, today, we're here to reflect on a man who I believe, and we were discussing this earlier at the table, who is still alive today, the dynamics of racial divide would be totally different. This was a true inspirational man. And in looking through some of the things that he said, I find one quote before we give the awards out that I thought was appropriate today in the environment that we're in. And I quote Dr. King, "The function of education is to teach one to think intensively and to think critically. Intelligence plus character, that is the goal of education." Okay, thank you for the words here and the names. Third place winners will receive a $20 gift card. The winners are Julie Niversa. Is Julie in the house? The next winner is J.P. Pearson from Whitney Academy. J.P. Pearson. There we go. The next winner is Aiden Miscoughlin. Aiden Miscoughlin. She is from Morton Middle School.
Congratulations.
Thank you so much.
The next winner is Savannah Pimentel from the Talbot Middle School. Here she comes. Oh, looks like we have an injury. Thank you. We can always wait for a winner. And those are our third place winners. Get a picture like that.
Okay, thank you everyone.
All right, our second place winners receive a $30 gift card. And they are Alana Young from the Cuss Middle School. Alana Young. Oh. The next winner, Nala Jovan from the Talbot Middle School. The next winner, Alexia Springer from the Talbot Middle School. There she comes. Hey, one out of three isn't bad. And our final winner in that category is Emily Valancourt. And for all those Frenchmen, it is Valancourt. Emily Valancourt. And now to the first prize. The first prize is a $40 gift certificate plus a gift certificate to take a course in the BCC Kids College. The winner is Emily Niversa from the Cuss Middle School. Excellent. Congratulations to all the winners.
Thank you, Michael. It's good to see the BCC alums in the mayor's office, isn't it? I would next like to invite up Cantor Shoshana Brown from Temple Beth El for a reflection. Cantor Brown.
So I didn't know I was giving a reflection today. I thought I was doing a prayer in lieu of my husband, who couldn't be here today, Rabbi Elber, and a song. And I wrote a little reflection, and then I decided not to do it because it would take too long. So now I'll do the reflection and the song and let the other ministers take care of the prayers. Today is happens to be the yard site that's the anniversary of the death of Abraham Joshua Heschel, who was a dear friend of King's and marched with him in Selma. It'll be, it's a 44th anniversary since his death. So that's one of our many Jewish connections with the civil rights movement. But I'm gonna tell you personally, I did not grow up Jewish, I converted, and I did not grow up in New England. I grew up as a white Protestant Christian in Hampton, Virginia. I learned to read in 1965 and have a faint memory of seeing benches at bus stops with the words white and coloreds stenciled on them. My parents belonged to a yacht club on Hampton Creek, which at the time I was a child, I'm sure was not open to membership for either blacks or Jews. Across the creek from the Hampton Yacht Club was a handsome brick building with a clock tower and a sprawling green lawn. That was Hampton Institute, now called Hampton University. It was one of the first black, actually it was formed as a black and American Indian colleges formed in America. Our public schools in Hampton, Virginia were frequently graced by visits of Hampton Institute's choirs, who would sing a cappella spirituals and gospel songs to us at school assemblies. Those visits impressed me deeply. So I want to thank those Hampton Institute choirs, but I want to tell you a little bit about the song that I'm going to sing. Every year I try to think, what am I going to do that I haven't done before? And it came to me somehow. I was reading some of King's letters, his letter from a Birmingham jail and his famous I Have a Dream speech. And it came to me, maybe I could take some of the phrases from these great writings and put them to appropriate music. But I want to also say that I have such a great love for black choirs, for gospel choirs, that I feel humbled as a white Jewish woman and a white woman who grew up in an oppressive racial environment in the South to be singing these. But I will say the Holy Spirit gave it to me, and it's King's words, and it's a tune that I did not write. So I'm just the channel, and if anybody and if your choir over there wants to take the words and go perform it someplace else, I would be really happy. So I'm calling the song Let Freedom Ring, because it's those are some of the words from one of King's speeches. There are a handful of words that I threw into the song to make it relevant or to make it rhyme, but 95% of the words are King's words. Injustice anywhere is a threat to justice everywhere. We are all caught in an inescapable network, tied in a single garment of destiny. Freedom. some, if you guys want to give me a hum, is never voluntarily given. It must be demanded by the oppressed. We will win our freedom, the sacred heritage of our nation, the eternal will of God, by whom we are blessed. I say to you, my friends, even though we face the difficulties of today and tomorrow, I still have a dream. No, we will not be satisfied until justice rolls down like waters, and righteousness like a mighty stream. Let freedom ring from the red hills of Georgia, from the curvaceous slopes of California. Let freedom ring from New York and Mississippi, even North Carolina, from every hilltop and street corner. Let freedom ring. Sing with me, freedom, oh freedom. Freedom, oh freedom, oh freedom of the land of the pilgrim's pride, from every mountainside, let freedom ring.
Cantor Shoshana Brown, ladies and gentlemen. The Distinguished African American Alumnus Award is presented yearly by the BCC Alumni Association to recognize outstanding achievement. Here to introduce the award is Carol A. Michael from the class of 1970, also from the BCC Alumni Association. Carol Michael.
Good morning. I'm privileged today to honor the recipient of the 2017 Distinguished African American Alumnus Awardee, and his name is Christopher Oyenuga. He graduated from Bristol Community College in 2012, and he went on to Wentworth, and then the University of Maryland. He has a BS in civil engineering and a master's of engineering in structural engineering and project management. He is a construction task supervisor at Bechtel. He's become a college recruiter for the National Society of Black Engineers. He's on the innovation team, virtual project delivery, 4D and 5D program in infrastructure, global business unit. Previously structural engineer in nuclear security and environmental global business unit. And he's received 5+ leader awards. Leader Plus Awards, I'm sorry. Christopher is a member of several organizations, too many to mention. He has led several community service events and planned, designed 2 Boston projects, Mission Hill Road Race and Wentworth Ski and Snowboard Club. Bridge mentor, mentoring the first and second year students. For 2 years, Project Management Institute, PMI member. To quote Christopher, I know that Bristol Community College helped shape me to the man I am today, and I'll never forget where I came from. I've been blessed with opportunity after opportunity, and none of that would have been possible without starting my journey here at Bristol Community College. I have been transformed through higher education, and it just keeps on getting better. Christopher Oyenuga, we are proud to name you as our Distinguished African American Alumnus Awardee of 2017.
Good morning, everybody. I'd like to just start off by congratulating Dr. Sprager for his legacy and what he's leaving here at Bristol Community College. So a round of applause for Dr. Jack Sprager. I'd also like to thank everybody who made this event possible and those who voted for my nomination. I'd like to congratulate the winners of the poster contest and the poem contest. So I'm honored to be named the 2017 Distinguished African American Alumnus of the Year Award recipient. I'd like to start off with a couple quotes that will help set the scene for this conversation. Education is the most powerful weapon which you can use to change the world. Nelson Mandela. My mission in life is not to strive, but to thrive, and to do so with some passion, some compassion, some humor, and some style. Maya Angelou. So I worked for 7 years in construction, which made my decision to enter civil engineering an easy one. We know that sometimes it's not easy to find out what you want to do for the rest of your life or pursue as a career. So in high school, I actually had a 2.8 GPA up in Nokomis High School in Newport, Maine. And I didn't have an idea of exactly what I would do, but I had an idea that it'd be towards the construction field. So I started my career at BCC in 2008, and I began to learn how to network and work with others and teams. At times, I was working 3 jobs at BCC to help provide money to go here for my books, transportation. So it wasn't too long ago that I was walking back and forth between the G building and walking back between classes during these vicious winters up here in Massachusetts. I'm currently living in Virginia. It's a little more mild down there, but not quite the South. So as I said, I found it was advantageous to work in groups as they can help you to learn faster and grow quicker. And at times you need to accept that you're going to make a fool of yourself. It's also important to accept that sometimes you'll fail. So it's important that you learn how to fail and fail safe. This will help you grow. It's also important for you to set your path and to stick to it. My father came to the States from Nigeria in the early 60s and 70s. You can believe how hard of a time that would be for an African American during those times. And a quote from my uncle is, given the resources that we had as we transferred to the US, think about the resources you have. So you should be able to have exponential success. They had to go to the libraries and get books. We have iPads and Google and internet and all these resources that you just need to harness to help you with your success. So it's also important that in life sometimes you take risks and be open. Allow yourself to be vulnerable and feel uncomfortable. I finished my education here at BCC in 2012 with a GPA of 3.19 and had a dean's list a few semesters. I decided that I wasn't done learning and I enrolled at Wentworth Institute of Technology in Boston, Massachusetts. While I was enrolled there, I became very involved with many student programs and living on campus. I was very involved with mentoring, volunteering, community service, as well as began to lead to grow as a leader, as well as a follower. I recognized that you need to learn how to follow and emulate the right people. I became the president of the National Society of Black Engineers, Wentworth chapter, which helped change my life. I was able to travel, network, and become a leader, and learn the importance of giving back. When you leave this earth, you want to be remembered as a net positive effect to your community. I grew as a man, a friend, a boyfriend, and an individual during my 3 years at Wentworth. So even with the recognition from the college through scholarships, campus acknowledgments, still, how do you measure your success? I'm focused on becoming a well-rounded individual, spiritually, intellectually, educationally, and in all directions. At times, you have to push yourself to your capacity to see what you can physically handle. At Wentworth, it was rare that I went to bed before 2 a.m., and then I woke up the next morning and did it all over again. The hard work forced me to work on my time management, and I realized that you had to invest time and not waste it. I learned also to work hard until it became a habit. In 2015, I finished my education at Wentworth, also with a 3.19, making the dean's list several semesters. Currently, I'm pursuing my Master's of Engineering at University of Maryland College Park in Structural Engineering and Project Management, where I have a 3.43. So I want to leave you with five B's that helped me with my success. So one B is be organic and genuine at all times. Also, be hungry. Also, be ready for obstacles. As well as be original. And finally, be humble at all times in all stages. Additionally, don't be discouraged by opposition, as it'll always be there. My father used to say, you fall down, and you get up, and you try again. And I still live by this mantra. You have to notice that not everybody will be for you, and at times there will be folks that are against you. So on this journey that you call a bus, you need to get the wrong people off the bus, and then get the right people on the bus, and then figure out where you're going with that bus. So I have a successful path as I continue into the professional arena, becoming a leader and philanthropist at my job, school, and community. As was said, I was a structural engineer in the nuclear security industry, and now I'm working with the infrastructure industry with innovation. Last week, I was in a meeting with the president of my company, discussing cultural issues that impact our company and country. I would never have believed that if you told me that at my graduation of high school in 2007. So I'd like to leave you with a few golden nuggets. Dare to be different. Also, be sure that the best is yet to come. And additionally, become the best you can. So I challenge you to become a statistic, and not the negative statistics you usually hear on CNN or the news. Become a statistic of an African-American who graduates college. Become a statistic of an African-American who completes a graduate program. Become a statistic of an African-American who is in engineering, or even better yet, an African-American female who enters the engineering field. I'm proud to be an alumnus of Bristol Community College. And on this day, let's take a few moments to reflect on those who have sacrificed and suffered in the past to make our present and future possible. Continue to strive for excellence. Thank you and God bless.
He's gonna get a picture.
We invite our BCC Vice Chair of our Board of Trustees, Diane Sylvia, to the podium.
Thank you, President Sprager, and welcome everyone. I would like to take this opportunity to invite Senator Michael Rodericks to the stage, please.
Thank you, Diane. Good morning, everyone. It's really always a great honor and pleasure to be here every year as we celebrate the life and legacy and the mission and the message of Dr. Martin Luther King. And we would not be gathered here each and every year as we have for the last 17 if it were not for the leadership of our good friend, Dr. Jack Sprager. And I wanted to take this opportunity on behalf of myself and my colleagues in the Bristol County Legislative Delegation, all of whom have now a location of Bristol Community College, Senator Mark Montigny in New Bedford, Senator Mark Pacheco in Taunton, and Senator Jim Timulty in Attleboro. And we all truly love and respect Dr. Jack Sprager. He is much more than just a professional acquaintance of all of ours. He is a personal friend, someone that we rely on as the model to how to deliver educational services to this region of the Commonwealth. And on behalf of all of them and on behalf of Senate President Stanley Rosenberg, I'm honored to present Dr. Sprager with an official Massachusetts state citation recognizing him for founding the Martin Luther King Jr. Breakfast in 2001 here at Bristol Community College, and it's become one of the most respected and preeminent community events here in Fall River. So thank you, Dr. Sprager, and congratulations.
I would like now to take the opportunity to invite State Representative Carol Fiola to the stage.
Good morning, thank you. I'd also will be joined by two of my colleagues that represent Fall River as well, State Representative Paul Schmidt and State Representative Alan Sylvia. And just a quick comment before we present our citation. Could I just ask all the young people who are still in the room, 18 or under, to stand? Are there any people still 18 or under in this room? Could you please stand? 18 or under, not 21 and under, 18 and under. Well, you're all in the back there, and I hope you realize that Dr. Sprager, BCC, and everyone that is here is doing this for you and for your future, because you are going to bear the torch, and you are going to spread the word, and you are going to live the word as you go on. So I think we need to give you an inspirational round of applause for the future that you will bring. And I was very moved this morning listening to the reflections, the singing, and the speaking. A month ago, I was in Israel and happened to be in the Holocaust Museum. Then I happened to be in Palestine in the West Bank. And You can only imagine the various thoughts, emotions, and feeling, and repression, and the history. And here we are today. And so, yes, we've come a long way. But I point out the youth of tomorrow because we have so much more to do. And it just, those thoughts were flooding through my mind as we are here today. And it's important to gather. Because as we leave here today, we're going to rush off to our worlds. And we're going to get busy and do what we do. But it's so important what you've done, Dr. Sprager, for the past 17 years of reminding us of the work we have to do. And Chris, amazing, wonderful, wonderful work. So with that, those few thoughts, thank you for letting me do that. My colleagues and I, not just Rep. Schmidt and Rep. Sylvia, but there are 16 state representatives that cover all the Bristol Community College campuses, and every one of them came over and signed this citation to you, President Sprager. And so they're a little crowded in here. And so I would like to just remind you that these are all the reps, in addition to us, that signed it. But your Fall River delegation is here this morning to present to you and thank you for leading this breakfast for 17 years and reminding us that we have much more to do. So thank you, thank President you. Sprager.
Thank you very much.
There's someone builds back there.
Oh, right there. Oh.
Okay. Thank you.
Thank you. Very touched.
Thank you, Diane. Thank you. Well, this is overwhelming. Thank you. I mean, this was not in the script. I don't know how we got here. But I thank you very much to the Senate and to the House of Representatives. Now, moving ahead, it's my honor to introduce our keynote speaker. Cape Verdean American filmmaker historian Dr. Claire Andre Watkins is professor of Africana and post-colonial media studies at the Institute for Liberal Arts and Interdisciplinary Studies at Emerson College. I just add as a note, my son and his wife are both Emerson alums now. And I think we're still paying for it, Joanne. I'm not sure. Dr. Andre Watkins was a 1995-1996 Fulbright Scholar in Cape Verde and a recipient of an American Philosophical Society grant in 1997. Please welcome for our keynote address, Dr. Claire Andre Watkins.
Good morning. I don't sing, and you should all be very grateful for that. Let me get myself settled. Thank you very much for that gracious introduction. And it's been a wonderful morning listening to people speak from their heart. And I'm kind of glad I'm last because I can tweak what I'm saying as I croak to you. But first I want to start by saying good morning, dear friends, in the year of the new. I refuse to say it's a new year because it's an old year of many lessons we're just about to learn. And I thank the committee members of the 17th annual Martin Luther King Breakfast for this invitation to share some thoughts today that reflect on tragic events that are happening in the world today and how it relates to Dr. Martin Luther King. This is a tall task for 15 minutes, which I'm going to try to make 10. However, it's time well spent in this current world of see something, say something, where the expectation is terror and fear. I reflect today from the perspective as a historian and filmmaker. As my father always said, nothing is going on under the sun that hasn't gone on before. History repeats itself, and the pendulum today has swung back 40 years to the hard-won civil rights legislation. And 30 years before that was the rise to fascism. The seminal 1903 work by W.B. Du Bois, Souls of Black Folk, said that the problem of the 20th century is the problem of the color line. I want to dial that back to the 1882 Chinese Exclusion Act that wasn't repealed until 1943. Jim Crow, that lasted from 1865 to 1964. The Johnson Immigration Acts of 1922 and 24. The 1941 to 1945 Japanese internment camps. The other side of the problem of these dates is the absence of those voices in the unbroken chronological timeline of race and color that goes back in America to the 1600s. History is a constructed narrative. Every semester, I begin my classes with the TED Talk by Nigerian novelist Chimamanda Ngozi Adichie. She talks about the danger of a single story. It is impossible to talk about a single story without talking about power, she continues.
I'm sorry, can I ask you to just step back a little bit on the mic? I think it's distorting as you're too close.
I'm too close. I just got a cue from the press, okay? And as a filmmaker, you listen to your boss. So I now have been corrected. And one of the things you learn is you graciously accept a lesson when somebody makes you better. That's lesson number one. It's impossible to talk about the single story without talking about power, she continues. Like our economic and political worlds, stories too are defined by the principles of power. How they are told, who tells them, when they are told, how many stories are told. Whoever asks the question shapes the answer. The single story creates stereotypes, and the problem with stereotypes is not that they are untrue, but that they are incomplete. They make one story become the only story. The consequence of the single story is this: it robs people of dignity. It makes our recognition of our equal humanity difficult. It emphasizes how we are different rather than how we are similar. The question, though, is how do you find your own story with other stories? How do you know what you don't know if you don't know what you don't know? Or how do you know, learn your history story if it's hidden, overlooked, forgotten, or lost? A more recent reference to Lost is the box office hit this weekend of Hidden Figures. Another one, 20 Feet from Stardom. The synopsis says, for 20 Feet from Stardom, millions know their voices, but no one knows their names. A current trend in some filmmaking circles is creating work from found footage. My question is, how did it get lost in the first place? Because the story was never told. This led me to kind of the point of my talk today, which is seeing with new eyes. As a filmmaker, my task and my vision since I left Fox Point in Providence in 1970 to go to college, was giving voice to the voiceless from my story. Where was the Cape Verdean story? My grandmother, my grandparents arrived in Fox Point in 1915. My other ones arrived down the Cape. And, you know, when I tell people what Cape Verdeans were, they'd say, oh, what an obscure people. So my journey to my now landmark film, Some Kind of Funny Puerto Rican, A Cape Verdean American Story, was to find the stories that were erased before they were written. One of my favorite stories in Some Kind of Funny Puerto Rican is from Manny Manuch Mendez, the griot of Fox Point. Part of this is finding the voices of those people that were never mentioned behind those dates and legislations. But the immigration legislation that was preceded by the Literacy Act of 1917 required immigrants to be able to read in their own language to enter the United States. Manny tells us this story. He said the immigration officers, of course, being from the British Isles, could only speak English as well. But they did not read or write Portuguese. So they'd hand them this paper, and the little Cape Verdean women from the old country would look at the papers, And being from little villages and stuff, where the men were educated and the women weren't, they would read the paper and say in Creole, which, Anya mai, which in Creole means, oh my mother, oh my mother. Immigration officials would snatch the paper, stamp them, and say, passed. They thought they were reading these papers in Portuguese. They were only making a comment in reference to the paper. And it was the funniest thing. So they sent word out to each other in the old country, just say, Anya mai, and you can come to America. This story about what America meant and these little stories are the ones that are hidden behind these moments of our past that meant a lot of the situation that we're here today. We know we exist because we have our memories, our stories, and we're holding on to them in the silences of the histories where we're absent. We were in the history of the Literacy Act. We lived it. The problem of the color line was not an abstraction in the 20th century, nor the preceding centuries, because the how in our voice doesn't exist does not mean we were not there, fully cognizant of these forces of power and privilege. Also, as Manny Mannucci recalls for us, we danced between those raindrops as part of our survival in the silences of histories where we were absent. Seeing with new eyes also means drilling down behind what you think you know to realize what you don't know, and learning to look around for the stories between the cracks. And in your journey of seeing, you're open to new knowledge. The film, Consul of Bordeaux, which is one I chose to distribute because it was a story I didn't know. How could I, a PhD in African studies, and you know, once you have a PhD, you know absolutely everything, right? But a PhD in specializing in Portuguese, Lusophone, Francophone, blah, 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 blah. And I came across this story and this film. So I chose to distribute it because it made me see with new eyes. It was learning about the courage of Aristides de Souza Mendes, the Portuguese Consul of Bordeaux, who saved 30,000 from persecution of Nazis and rising fascism. His courage and choice of personal conviction for justice and humanity transcended race and religion. He chose to live a moment of greatness, not a moment of written history. His story is one of those dancing between the raindrops of the history of power and that hope and faith, and that indeed there are always these seeds of justice, humor, humanity along the timeline of the history of pain, injustice, and hate. What does this mean? Well, for me as the historian, within the chaos of history are always the seeds of hope for the future. And this is where I return to the trail and path of Martin Luther King. Martin Luther King's journey between 1963 and 1968, for me, really runs the gamut from local, global, to universal. Seeing with New Eyes is a journey following Martin Luther King and the lesson of inspiration and his perspicacity. That's a Lincoln School prep school word with Miss Stanhope in the 12th grade. Thank you very much, perspicacity. Seeing with new eyes, the power of privilege in history, and then the global and universal struggle beyond race to the scourge of addressing poverty and injustice. In April of 1963, in his Birmingham letter, Martin Luther King also speaks about history. History is the long and tragic story of the fact that privileged groups seldom give up their privileges voluntarily. Individuals may see the moral light and voluntarily give up their unjust posture, but as Reinhold Niebuhr says and reminded us, groups are more immoral than individuals. We know through painful experience that freedom is never voluntarily given up by the oppressor. It must be demanded by the oppressed. Those words are as prescient today as they were in 1963. He went from August 28, 1963, from I Have a Dream, where my children will be judged by their character, followed in rapid succession by landmark legislation, the 1964 Civil Rights Act, the 1965 Voting Rights Act, the Immigration Act of 1965, that lifted those quotas, that made those immigrants say, "I'm your mai, I can come to America." And then he came to the mountaintop in April 1968. History repeats itself, and the words he spoke then are just as relevant, if not more so, today. The nation is sick, trouble is in the land, confusion all around. That's a strange statement, but I know somehow that only when it is dark enough can you see the stars. And I see God working in this period of the 20th century in a way that men in some strange way are responding. Something is happening in the world. Doesn't this sound like today? The masses of people are rising up. And wherever they are assembled today, whether they are in Johannesburg, South Africa, Nairobi, Accra, Ghana, New York City, Atlanta, the cry is always the same. We want to be free. All we say to America is be true to what you said on paper. But as the historian, not the cynic, and also as a former almost law student, any law that is written can be rescinded. How do you make a law about humanity and then your civil rights and take it away? We have work to do. Martin Luther King was assassinated in 1968. And the quote, I'm going to rephrase it again, "Injustice anywhere is a threat to justice everywhere. We are caught in an inescapable network of mutuality, tied in a single garment of destiny. Whatever affects one directly affects all indirectly. Never again can we afford to live with the narrow provincial outside agitator idea." What were my lessons from MLK for today? About growing up in Fox Point, the community on the other side of the Braga Bridge. There's two worlds, Fox Point, Fall River, and New Bedford. If you go from one village to another, you need to pack a sandwich. Because Fall River, you didn't stop. You're on your way from Fox Point to see your godmother in New Bedford. We are all part of a history in this part of New England and Massachusetts. Many of us share the 500-year connection of being a descendant of Portugal and Portuguese colonies. When I grew up, I often said poverty is a state of mind. In Fox Point, we were poor, but it's a state of mind, but we were rich in everything else. I never knew I was poor or called poor until I went to college in 1970. I left from Planet Street, went to Boston, and I went in 1970, largely as part of that wave made possible by that law we're now fighting to regain our humanity. I'm here as part of the paying forward of a dream that began that is still not complete in 1968. A couple of years ago, when I was thinking about the Martin Luther King holiday, I read an article that made a light bulb go off in my head. I realized that the economic base provided by Local 1329 of the ILA, the International Longshoremen's Union, founded in 1933, and the first black, predominantly Cape Verdean union on the Eastern Seaboard, founded by the immigrants, my great uncles, my cousins, down into this generation. I realized that the economic base provided by Local 1329, throughout most of the 20th century, continuing to the present day, shielded us somewhat and enabled our very small ethnic community of color to avoid some of the pitfalls of institutional racism, of slavery, that Johnson's war on poverty and Martin Luther King's anti-poverty concerns were trying to alleviate. Our demise as a community is race, but the other face of privilege through urban renewal and gentrification. Poverty is not only about employment, a job, or racism, or a deficit in character, or industriousness. It's more insidious than that. It's the systemic results of the causal links between economic equity and justice and access to resources and power to provide basic human needs, rights, affordable housing, and the capacity to dream, aspire, and achieve. Dreams matter. One of the things that I brought with me today is a family heirloom. My Portuguese is bad. I will not punish any of you who are fluent Portuguese speakers. But this is metade da língua inglesa. My grandfather, who was born in 1887 in Sandton Town, Cape Verde, came to the Cape before it became the gentrified Cape, raised his 10 children, and as an illiterate, taught himself English. He took this book, walked all those sandy roads down the Cape to help the other immigrants who came learn English so they could become citizens. Our story isn't there in the big history books. The Literacy Act probably was the joke that got a lot of people here. But the dream and aspiration of education and what it meant means a lot for many of us in this room because everybody came from somewhere. Thank you, Seraphine Montero. The other lesson of my film that's gone around the world is that it resonates on a universal level of shared humanity. Everywhere it's gone, audiences love it. And they tell me, this is my story, our story, because everyone comes from somewhere. A memorable moment was the premiere of this in Lisbon. And I was a little bit nervous, given the centuries of tension between the black and white Portuguese, as we are affectionately called in some circles. At the end of the screening, a Portuguese gentleman approached me crying. And although he didn't speak English very well, he said, "This story," he said, "it touched me." That's when I realized that our shared humanity is the universal connector and justice is the goal. The story of a community that had dreams and hope, believed in education, believed in family, this was something that everybody around the world can relate to because it's you. Seeing with new eyes means taking that leap of faith into the unknown. That although the pendulum is swung back, the seeds for the next steps toward the light are in the darkness of this moment. 40 years ago, the pendulum pushed away forward to opportunities. I'm standing here as one of those. My PhD, yeah, I'm smart, okay? But it came from the waterfront and my mother cleaning houses 35 miles away. That pendulum, when I left Planet Street in 1970, gave me opportunities, put me on the path to higher education. All of us from the point in my generation, all of us went to college. This was only less than 100 years from when my grandparents came from Cape Verde. I went to Simmons, my cousin went to Emerson. Now is the time to pay forward for the next wave. The journey continues. And as with any journey, it's about choices. It's about faith. And I always think about Walt Whitman's poem, Two Roads Diverged in Yellow Wood. Two roads diverged in yellow wood, and sorry I could not travel both. And be one traveler long I stood, and looked down one as far as I could, to where it bent in the undergrowth, then took the other just as fair, and having perhaps the better claim, because it was grassy and wanted wear. Though as for that, the passing there had really warned them about the same. And both that morning equally lay, in leaves no step had trodden black. Oh, I kept the first for another day, yet knowing how way leads on to way, I doubted if I should ever come back. I shall be telling this with a sigh, somewhere ages and ages hence. Two roads diverged in a wood, and I took the one less traveled by, and that has made all the difference. The lesson of this, take the road less traveled. Martin Luther King did. Teach yourself to see not something, see something new. Say something, not just say something through action. Actions that overcome hate with love and compassion. We have to care and share. Seeing with new eyes. Martin Luther King isn't dead, because his vision is as live as it was 40 years ago. It's a beacon for universal humanity, tolerance, fighting against poverty and injustice. What are our weapons? My grandfather's was this, right? Will, tenacity, hope, faith, love. We can do this, right? The power of change starts with one, you. Know your history. Behind you is a slide I asked them to put up. That's a memory pot. Last Saturday, I'm going to try not to cry. I went to the memorial of my best friend of 50 years from Providence. Candy was white. I was not. If anybody knows Providence history, you know Benefit Street is the most historic street, historically, symbolically, capitalism, slave trade, that shaped the last 500 years. It shapes the world that we're in with what's happening on Friday. All of it started on Benefit Street. Candy lived off Benefit Street to the top. I lived off Benefit Street to the bottom, because all of us at the bottom were the Cape Verdeans who cleaned the houses for the people at the top. Candy and I were friends since seventh grade. Henry Barnett, and then we went to Lincoln School. Lincoln, wonderful school, 50 girls in the graduating class. Needless to say, Candace was white without money. I was the only one. That seems to be my distinction in life. Our other very good friend was the one Jew in the class. There were two. And that became a friendship for 50 years. I took the bus last Saturday to what Candace's husband calls, rightly, Maine being the whitest state in the Union. I agree with him. And I was going to Augusta, which is so far inland, I couldn't flee off the coast even if I wanted to. So I went up to Waterville, Maine. But what I did before I got on that bus, Candace died on the 23rd of December. I last talked to her on December 13th when she was very high on morphine in her stage 4 cancer, but as Candace always was, very lucid. She asked me, she said, Claire, what are your blink moments? I said, what do you mean blink moments? She said, when you think about your life, what are your blink moments? This is somebody on their deathbed. She said, my blink moments were my family. And then she said, her time at Lincoln. I realized that our friendship 15 years later was really unusual. I started at Lincoln in 67. It was before, barely, when all of the sacrifices that Martin Luther King did, a seed was being planted, and I didn't know that. We were friends, and we weren't supposed to be friends. Candace told me many years later that her mother would tell her, Candy, you know, if you keep socializing with Claire, those other girls aren't going to want to be your friend. Our friendship survived and thrived as humans for 50 years. I went the way that the stereotype of a single story forced me to go. But I never forgot where I came from. My job is to tell the stories of our memory. What's your job? That memory pot. I thought of what Candy said, and as a historian, I realized how important that street on Benefit Street is for all of us in our history at this moment. So last Friday, this now senior citizen went and took a teaspoon. I went to the tree on Butler Avenue, where we all used to hang at Lincoln, and in the snow, so here's this black woman with a hoodie and a tablespoon saying, okay, please, all right. Went, dug out some dirt from under the tree. Then I went to her house on Benevolent Street. Again, here's me with my hoodie going into somebody's backyard, digging up dirt. Then I went to my house, which had been a victim of urban renewal and destroyed our community. And I dug out some dirt from what but our front yard. This was the essence of who we were. So I built a memory pot for her. On the bottom, I put the seeds and the shells of Cape Verde. Why? Because everything in this room started in 1462 when the Portuguese settled Cape Verde, the first permanent European settlement in the New World. All of us came from there. Almost every ship for two centuries passed through Cape Verde. So on the bottom, I put the shells because it is all of our humanity. Then I put a layer of Candace's soil from her childhood home, another layer of shells from my street for our friendship, another layer of shells, and at the top I put the soil from Lincoln. And at the top of it, I added a candle. So it's not that Candace is gone, but the legacy of what's in that memory pot has a light for the future, because the story of our humanity and friendship, like Martin Luther King's, always goes forward. What is your story? What is your change? How are you going to see with new eyes? Thank you. Thank you, President Sprague, for my mic.
Thank you. That was wonderful. Thank you very much. Thank you, Dr. Claire Andre Watkins. Thank you very much. Well, we're coming to the end. I'd like to invite Most Reverend Jay Maddock from Holy Name to Parish and Seminarian Juan Carlos to join us on the stage. Come on. While he's making his way to the stage, we have a tradition of everybody rising to sing We Shall Overcome at the breakfast. Let's do verses 1 and 3 only, okay? And who's going to start us? Joanne? Yeah. And then we'll have our benediction, okay? So we, who's going to start us off? I will, I guess. Get the right notes. Okay, we shall overcome.
We shall overcome. We shall overcome someday.
Thank you. Now it's my honor to introduce Most Reverend Jay Maddock from the Holy Name Parish to provide the benediction.
What a great morning. Thank you, my friends. It's wonderful to be here with all of you to take part in this year's celebration of the life and mission of Dr. King. Many years ago, I had the privilege here in Fall River of being involved in programs celebrating Dr. King's life and legacy when the now retired Judge Thomas Quinn, who was presiding over the juvenile court here in Fall River, when he would put together a program in his courtroom with wonderful speakers who inspired us to work hard to carry on the mission of nonviolent, peaceful resolutions to the woes and injustices in our country. As we all know, many years later, 17 years ago, Dr. Jack Sprague initiated this annual breakfast and prayer service in honor of Dr. King, in the hope of inspiring people in these days not to abandon the work and mission of one who ultimately gave his own life for the cause of justice and righteousness. Dr. Sprague and Joanne are wonderful friends and parishioners of mine at Holy Name Church. Like Dr. King, they put their trust in the Lord, and with his strength, accept and fulfill many challenges to make our homes, our towns, our country, and the world better places in which to live. It's an honor for me to be with them and all of you for this final tribute to Martin Luther King Jr. here at BCC under Jack's presidency. So let us now pray for the blessing of our good and gracious God. Lord, we offer you praise and thanksgiving for the opportunity to be together on the day when this nation honors the life and legacy of our brother, Dr. Martin Luther King Jr. We are blessed to be reminded once again of his desire to do your good work on this earth, to live not just for himself and his own desires, but to pursue his dream and your will that all people should be freed from the chains of sin, which prevent us from having a world in which justice and peace prevails. This day, we ask you to send your bountiful blessings upon all throughout the world who are gathered to remember the courage, hope, and determination of Dr. King, which inspired him and many others to devote their lives to the cause of bringing to an end poverty, lack of education, and the absence of true freedom and equality to countless numbers in our land. May we who celebrate and give thanks for the leadership, vision, and dream of Dr. King receive now your strength and inspiration to work in our day to make that dream become a reality. May the words of the psalmist help us not only to remember and honor Dr. King, but to be mindful it is now our turn to help justice to prevail. And the psalmist says, "The just one is a light in darkness to the upright. Well for the one who conducts their affairs with justice. They shall never be moved. The just one shall be in everlasting remembrance. An evil report they shall not fear. Their heart is firm. Trusting in the Lord, their heart is steadfast. They shall not fear. Lavishly they give to the poor. Their justice shall endure forever. Their horn shall be exalted in glory." Send us forth now from this place, O Lord, we pray, with hearts and minds and souls and bodies renewed and refreshed, to understand the vision of Dr. King still needs to become a reality in our country and our world. Help all people to know your call to us to do our part in turning that vision and dream into the way of life for all your children. Help all to hear and follow your words. Do not be afraid, for I am with you. Praise, honor, and thanksgiving to you, O God, now and forever. Amen.
Well, thank you very much for coming. This is a historic week in American history with the inauguration, and we have to keep in mind Dr. King's spirit. It's going to be quite a challenge for us. I want to thank once again our musicians, Louis Lima and Michael Crowley, Gary Lyon and Living Water. Please don't forget the free course on Martin Luther King that you can register at the table right here. And don't forget this morning the celebration at Bethel AME Church on Hanover Street, Reverend Darrell Malden presiding. Thank you so much for coming. It's been a great 17 years. Enjoy. Thank you.